America is essentially a dream.
Good evening. Welcome to Network X. I'm your host, David Fisher. Tonight, we're going to look at the mayor's race. And with us tonight, we have Geov Parrish, who's known for being on KCMU. He does a morning show talk once a week, and also has a column, several papers, and he writes for independent media, Eat the State.
Yes, and a weekly column on The Stranger called Geov Politic.
Okay, good. Welcome to the show tonight.
Thanks.
Okay. And to his left, we have Matthew Fox, who has been a citizen activist for some time in Seattle, is currently managing Charlie Chong's...
Charlie Chong's
what
campaign.
Are you?
I'm still a legislative assistant to Charlie Chong at the city council, and I do, I guess, a lot of campaign work, but I'm not the campaign manager.
Ah, okay. Well, now that was mentioned the other day in the paper.
And it was inaccurate.
Okay.
It was inaccurate. I did not see. I actually called it in and said I needed a correction because Jay Sauceda, Charlie's other legislative aide, he's on leave right now running the campaign.
Okay.
And we have Tim Baker from Capitol Hill Community Council in the office now. And that was a miswriting and a...
Okay.
You had no way of knowing.
Something inaccurate about Charlie Chong's campaign in the papers?
And
I can't hardly believe that.
The lesson is the mistake is much more prominent than the retraction. So the correction, you know, it always runs on page
sure.
two in about 4-point font. So
right, and several days later usually too, right?
That's right.
Well, then let's get to our main point then. What we want to look at is the mayor's race, and we want to examine how the media has covered it. And I'm going to start off and ask Matthew what he thinks, some of the retorts, I guess, or the counter argument to some of Joni Balter's columns, who have been very unflattering, and of course, Terry McDermott.
We almost have to go back to the beginning, which is the fact that Paul Schell is in the race because essentially Mindy Cameron publicly implored him to, in a column sometime back in June of this year, basically sort of this dreamy column about how wonderful it would be if a real visionary like Paul Schell were to jump in the race, and Paul Schell had previously said he wasn't going to run.
Mindy Cameron being the editorial page editor of the Times, just for people who aren't familiar with the names.
Okay.
Thanks, So in any event, she really started beating the drum for him to jump in, was, you know, patting herself on the back after he did. Joni Balter then launched a series of columns, started first with the one that said, potholes really aren't a problem, stop talking about them. The second one essentially said, in so many words, look, potholes aren't a problem, quit talking about them. We don't want to hear about them. Or at least their editorial page didn't want to hear about them. And that whole, you know, kind of pattern of infrastructure neglect that has become an issue over the last few years since the Commons campaign, I think. And then she started to get kind of nasty and really sort of started to go after Charlie personally. And, you know, called him the Mr. Road Rage of Seattle politics and said he was Mr. Yuck. And anyone who's ever seen, met, or, you know, watched Charlie work knows that he is far from it. I mean, Charlie is a delightful guy, great sense of humor. And it was just, you know, really nasty. And she hasn't written one for a while. And I think maybe it's because she realized the more she wrote them, the more people would, like, send us money and volunteer for our campaign. I don't know what it was.
I said she had to stop.
Something like that. I don't know.
It was defeating her purpose, in other words.
Yeah, I think. And since then, the editorial pages have quieted down some. The PI did something interesting. We refused to go to the editorial pages in the primary election because in the case of the Times, we wrote them a letter that said, look, you guys have been hammering on me. You've said I'm a crank. You've said I'll be a lousy mayor. You said I'm scary, this, that. Why should I come in and talk to your editorial board? I declined to be interviewed for endorsement by the Times. And then we wrote one to the PI because Charlie, the PI historically, first time he went to the PI in 1995 when he was running for council the first time, he walked in there and just got hammered for his positions on the comprehensive plan. And he turned to the three people hammering him for it and said, how many of you actually read the comprehensive plan? Of which one said, well, in part. And so, you know, similar thing. This time out, though, We had an impact, though, because the PI ran that piece you saw the other week where Charlie and Paul Schell each did, they had a court reporter transcribe their answers to questions and just printed it verbatim. Yeah. I thought it was actually a really great.
It was a Sunday paper.
Yeah. It was a really great piece, and you know, you really got some insight. There was more depth. It was long enough that, you know, they could really get into their issues, and I thought that was a real improvement in the coverage, actually, so I was delighted to see that. I'm sure. Well, I don't know how they're going to endorse, but I have a feeling I know. They did. Oh, incidentally, in the primary, as a result of not going to the PI, the Times, or no, excuse me, the Post Intelligencer editorial endorsed Schell, said nice things about Greg Nichols, had a few kind words for Cheryl Chow and Jane Noland, and did not say anything about Charlie Chong. Like, his name wasn't even there. Like, not even like, don't vote for this guy, but like, his name wasn't there.
Let's X out his name.
Yes. That's been true of a lot of the coverage, and it's been a real interesting lesson, I think, for people who watch media in this city and the role of media in this city in a year in which one of the major electoral issues is, you know, insider politics, the political process, the way public policy decisions are made in Seattle. A lot of people feeling like it's been a very top-down process under Mayor Rice. Neighborhoods aren't involved. The comprehensive plan was an excellent example of this. You know, all the different corporate welfare schemes like the stadiums that really have been shoved down people's throat. It really has been revealing to watch the way the two daily papers in particular have positioned themselves and to realize that they are part of that insider establishment and that they are not giving people any, in any sense of the word, any kind of a, you know, neutral, objective presentation either of what the issues are in the race or of what the candidates' positions are on them. It is virtually impossible, and you know, I by no means think Charlie Chong is an ideal candidate, but it is virtually impossible over the last 6 months to find articles in the Times or the PI that has Chong's name in them without adjectives like gadfly, screwball, you know, West Seattle secessionist leader, etc. It's, you know, things putting him down, things trivializing his statements, trivializing his persona, whereas you never see any kind of you know, those kind of adjectives with Paul Schell. There, you know, he's visionary, he's dynamic, an aggressive business leader, yada yada yada. You have really had to go, I think, to some of, well, certainly the Weekly and the Stranger, the weekly papers in town, and some of the alternative smaller media. The Seattle Press has done a very good job. Terry Denton's paper.
Denton's excellent. James Bush has been.
Yeah, but it has been real reveal, and of course, you know, on the TV stations, even though this is the most important local election that we've had here in the last 8 years, it's impossible to get more than 15 seconds from our chuckle buddies, you know, on the evening news, you know, before they go on to, so how about those Seahawks, Dave? Yeah. It's very, very frustrating in terms of trying to get democracy in this city, because to have democracy you have to have an informed electorate, and people really have to be seeking out the details of what the candidates' positions are, who their supporters are, how they will prospectively run the city in order to get a sense of where we're going and what the election actually means. That's true of all of the races, but even in a very high profile race like a mayor, the places where people are getting, most numbers of people are getting their information, the dailies and the TV stations are offering a very distorted picture of what this race is about.
Let's talk about that some more right now. I want to ask Matthew a question here. Correct me, if the perception of Mr. Yuck is this loner, naysayer, that just no, I want to be, but in fact, what is the case with Charlie? Wasn't he actually moving along and picking up council members as he moved?
Well, what's interesting is if you've ever watched the tapes of Channel 28 meetings, you'll find that Charlie, like, about 95% of the time votes with the rest of the council.
And 95%
of absolutely. You know,
okay. We had an article about that in the state this past week.
Yeah, what happens is on serious issues, he has taken stands, and sometimes they've been 8-1 stands, such as Holly Park, which actually was 7-1 because someone didn't vote on that. I believe it was Jane Noland wasn't voting. Okay. And, you know, he took a stand on that. And I think he took the right stand. I think history is going to prove him right. I think you're going to see, over time, a net loss in low-income housing units at Holly Park, and it's going to cost a hell of a lot of money. And it's fraught with risk, the way they've set up the financing. I think that project, I hope it doesn't turn bad, but it has a lot of potential not to do good stuff. The other votes, like Sandpoint, were 6-3. He was joined by Jane Noland, Sue Donaldson. The Parks Enhanced Enforced Ordinance, which is the latest Sidran thing where basically they can kick you out of parks without what I view as due process, was a 7-2 vote. Richard McIver joined Charlie. And upon reflection, there were some others, you know, that people had joined him on. And by and large, he's worked with people and I think has done a lot of good and has changed the agenda. And for this is a good example. We wanted to move the business meetings of the council out of this anonymous little out-of-the-way 10th floor conference room, which was technically open, but you could barely find, and you weren't exactly welcome if you showed up in that if you were a citizen. They had a lot of their best briefings there, a lot of serious policy discussions. We wanted it out in chambers open, where it could be broadcast and people could attend if they wanted to.
Accessibility.
And we went around and around and around and just got bogged down in this mindless process because they did not want Charlie to have a legislative victory, period, no matter how minor, no matter how, basically, because it is not the end of the world. It's not going to cost the city a lot of money, any of this. It was pure spite, pure spite. What happens the week after we get voted down on that? They hold their business meeting in chambers. And every so often, they still do that now. So Charlie, you know, he's making a dent, even if these people don't want to give him an ounce of credit for it.
They won't give him any credit, but things are being changed.
Yeah, and another good example is Sandpoint. The city, following the 6-3 Sandpoint vote, adopted the mayor's plan to give about 15 acres away to the University of Washington. All this stuff. They did a feasibility study to find out if there'd be private money like they were hoping for to help fund some of these programs. Feasibility study criticized the plan for, quote, and I mean, we could have written this thing, lacking vision, being a hodgepodge, not having an overarching theme. You know, all these things that we said, we wanted to aim it at being a parks and recreation center with a housing element. The city sort of went at it the other way, which is like the housing, all these different things, some of which solved city needs, some of which were things like storage, and didn't look at it with a big picture view. And as a result, they've got a plan that's a real stinker. And even Paul Schell admits should be revisited.
And they had 5 years to do it. I mean, they've been working on that plan. They have known that the Navy was going to be giving that that acreage to the city for a long time.
So 5 years to create a mess of a plan.
In fact, several of the comments in the study actually say the city, one of them said the city should be held criminally liable for allowing this to happen or something like that. I mean, it was a stunning thing to read, you know. Oh, another one Charlie got hammered on, this municipal campus plan, this notion that we're going to make Key Tower City Hall by putting a $5 million front door on it and building all these new court sites and selling off historic buildings we bought 10 years ago, and a lot of nonsense. And Charlie said it was nonsense. We get hammered in the paper. Terry McDermott, in that article you alluded to, slams him for saying the council shouldn't be 39 floors above, the council mayor shouldn't be 40 floors above the people. Lo and behold, quietly, a couple weeks ago, we get this report from Allied Arts saying Key Tower shouldn't be our long-term city hall. It's not suitable for it. City council and the mayor shouldn't be 40 floors above the people. You know, just point after point, I was just like, and do we get any credit? No, we don't.
Not at all. Well, let's move on then.
Oh, so, and a media thing on that is the Times wrote an editorial saying that the other day about Sandpoint and just couldn't bring themselves to mention the name of Charlie Chong. They just couldn't do it.
Who originally was the one that brought this whole to everyone's attention.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah, very much so.
So the media spin as we see it, so Charlie's being portrayed one way, and in actuality it's not true at all. It's just, and Schell has been portrayed, as you say, a visionary and so forth. What's the actual Schell? I know they had two articles came out Tuesday on...
Well, the Stranger article I've got coming out next week on the elections basically summarizes Paul Schell's appeal is in the mudslide neighborhoods. You know, people in the primary who voted for him, places like, you know, the Rim around Queen Anne, Magnolia, North Capitol Hill, these are people who are accustomed to spending an awful lot of money for something that's very good to look at while the foundation is oozing out from underneath them. And I think that's a, you know, that's a pretty good summary for Paul Schell's politics. You know, if you don't want the 2012 Olympics in Seattle, you probably should, and the, you know, the Norman B. Rice, you know, memorial synchronized volleyball field house, you know, at a cost of $400 million, then you probably don't want Paul Schell. He has, in his record, certainly over the last many years, both. You know, in his work with the Port Commission and his work as a developer in town, the reason why he has had such a well-fueled campaign with so much money, both with his developer contacts and with his contacts and his work with the Port of Seattle, is that he has made a career out of redirecting public money into the pockets of the stockholders of extremely wealthy, extremely, you know, well-to-do transnational corporations, large businesses. That's what Paul Schell's politics are about, making lots of money for the very wealthy. with taxpayer money. You know, we've seen it at the port with any number of developments, the Pier 66 thing. We've got terminal expansions going on, both at Terminal 5 and Terminal 18. Terminal 5 is a $270 million expansion that is being done specifically for one corporation, American Presidential Lines. Terminal 18 for the stevedores, same thing, $300 million. You know, these are projects on the scale of the stadiums that have caused such a brouhaha over the last couple, 3 years, and there has been no public visibility for them. There's no accountability. The port itself, is a fairly obscure agency in terms of its public visibility. Hopefully, one good thing that may come out of Shell's running for mayor is that people will be more aware of where their tax money is going. But but you've got these.
You'll be able to see it being built downtown.
Well, that too.
Traffic.
But no, let's not go there. But you know, you've got financing schemes for this where they're creating separate bond issuing agencies so that the port doesn't have direct liability, and so that also people have a much harder time following the paper trail of seeing that the tax money is going, you know, directly into very wealthy corporate interests. We've seen this with all the development that was going on downtown with Cornerstone, where Paul Shell, on behalf of Westinghouse, was building a number
Weyerhaeuser,
of...
Weyerhaeuser, actually.
Weyerhaeuser, I'm sorry. It was one of those W companies, but yes, Weyerhaeuser. had all of these projects in the late 80s, right at the time that the real estate market went bust, and as was mentioned in the papers the other day, his projects had not done very well. We've got the Pier 66 Conference Center. You know, what is the Port of Seattle doing in the convention business? We've got the port itself being one of the only ports on the West Coast that is a money-losing proposition, even though there's tremendous capacity there. The reason it's a money-losing proposition is that so much of the money is going back into the users, going back into the corporations doing it. Those kind of priorities are what I fear are going to are going to be emblematic of Paul Shell's reign as mayor, should he become mayor. We have real severe potential for budgetary problems in the city of Seattle over the next few years. You know, the economic cycle moves in cycles. We're in good times right now. It's not going to last. The city is very poorly prepared in terms of its commitment to major projects, in terms of the loss of state and federal funding that it's looking at. And, you know, Matt knows these budget numbers a lot better than I do. But, you know, when those tough decisions need to be made, the question, and I think Charlie's record has been somewhat problematic on some of the social issues, although he's been very good on some things also. But in terms of, do you want a fiscal conservative in office? Somebody who is open to the public, somebody who is willing to listen to public and neighborhood input before making decisions when those hard decisions have to be made, or someone whose priority for the last quarter century has been making his friends rich? I really think that's what that is what this election comes down to, and it's real disturbing to me that we might have Shell on our hands for the next 4 years.
Oh, well, that's interesting. You say make his friends rich. These articles, especially in the Weekly, talked about the fact that he lost money, but he managed to get out just before the money left. Mm-hmm. And several of the people that he was associated with, especially in this Cornerstone development, were left holding the bag. And it's interesting, but they all back him now.
Oh, yeah.
They're hoping for better times ahead, I guess.
Yeah, and there are probably other things, other deals that they've had going on with him, too.
Mm-hmm. I think, and I've seen Folke Nyberg, who's a UW architecture prof, really kind of made this point. The Shell is very much into that blending of public and private interests, and that's been a hallmark of the Rice administration. It will not be a hallmark of a Chong administration. In fact, I had the pleasure of going to a executive board meeting of the Downtown Seattle Association. And this is when Nichols and Charlie were still sort of in that absentee count phase where they were neck and neck, you know, and Charlie was pulling ahead slowly. At that point, it sort of looked like it was going to be Charlie. In any event, in fact, Greg announced later that day. That was the day that Greg conceded, basically. And they did their thing, and Charlie did his thing, and he said at the end, he said, and you know, you people downtown, you have nothing to fear from me. You know, I'm going to be mayor for all the people of the city, and downtown is a neighborhood like any other neighborhood in the city. just don't come asking for money. Because the days when John or Jim Ellis can walk into the mayor's office and walk out with $15 million for the Mariners, the convention center, those days are over, and I'll show you the books, and you'll agree with me. And I was just sitting there going, that was the greatest thing I've ever seen anyone say in my life. And he just lost every vote in this room. But that's Charlie. He's very honest. you will get open government. And frankly, I think Paul Schell has a miserable record on open government. The port is notoriously...
It's awful.
Their open government record is wretched. You look at things like the fact that they only got around to adopting an affirmative action plan this year, and you know, affirmative action, regrettably for the time being, is on its way out. You know, I mean, and it's this year that they get around to that. They've had terrible history of labor disputes. You have this case of a guy named Al Fernie, who is of the Pork Patrol, sued the port to get the salaries of public employees. And didn't sue, rather, he just, under the Open Meetings Act, or Open Records Act, you know, he requested the records, they denied it. The port then countersued him, and he wound up having to pay him $8,000 in attorney's fees, and Paul Schell sort of defended that decision, and I think it was a terrible decision. I think that's public information.
Absolutely.
And, you know, I should almost just pipe in and say, you know, as an overpaid city employee, I'm making $24 an hour, I mean, I've got to at least be honest and consistent, and that's public information. If you were to call our office and ask, I would tell you. And the notion that you would withhold something as petty as that makes me wonder about the stuff they're really going to withhold in terms of how they're cutting the deal that gets you a $300 million expansion of Terminal 5, or how Paul Schell in the 80s tried to build a hotel over the waterfront in violation of the Shorelines Management Act, had to be sued by the League of Women's Voters and I think a conservation group, although I may have the specific details of who sued him wrong. He was sued for that, and to this day the port is, or not the port, but Pier 1, Pier 2 on West Seattle, there's a proposal to build a hotel there. And Mr. Schell, you know, has a history of backing these kind of public-private proposals. I'm fairly sure the port was very supportive of the proposal to tear down the Alaskan Way Viaduct and replace it with a fewer-lane toll road tunnel in order to redevelop the waterfront with condominiums. And this is something that Mr. Schell has said while he's saying now, oh, well, I really don't want to do that, besides there's no money for it. This is something they've stated as a goal, and these are important things to have on the record.
And a guy who can talk about a few million dollars here and there, you know, being missing or misspent as, oh, that's no big deal.
Oh, is that what he says? It's just nothing.
You remember that.
What was it? It was the a $2.6 million project that had like a $3 million overrun.
Yeah,
and Paul Schell's response was, no one's perfect.
Yeah, that was his exact quote. Nobody's perfect.
So accessibility and accountability are two things that are really important in an elected official.
Well, and how you want your tax money spent. I mean, you know, how did the people in this city, you know, do you want... Given that we have good economic times right now for a lot of people, not everybody, but for a lot of people, there are at the same time a number of real serious problems that we're facing as a city. Housing costs are going through the roof.
Right.
Transportation is a real problem.
Yes.
You know, there are a number of issues that the next mayor of Seattle is going to need to deal with, is going to need to deal with in a systematic way, and is going to need to get a lot of public input from a lot of different sectors of the community in order to make good decisions and provide good leadership. Do you want somebody whose idea of being a visionary, as evidenced by his track record over the last two decades, is with these kind of projects as a solution for whatever ails you? You know, it just doesn't seem to me that that's appropriate.
So the third A is by association.
Well, the other thing I think, too, is if you look at a project, I think one of the biggest things the mayor faces coming up is going to be RTA implementation.
Yep.
The next couple mayoral terms is going to be a big deal.
Yes.
And if you're out there in Rainier Valley wondering what's going to happen to your neighborhood, how your business impacts are going to be mitigated, I think you'd rather have Charlie Chong at the helm listening to people in the neighborhoods about where they want the thing rooted and what they're going to need to keep their businesses going through the construction phase. Because if you remember 3rd Avenue, the construction for the bus tunnel, you know, had an enormous impact on a lot of businesses on 3rd Avenue. As a result, we've had to build a symphony hall to clean the block up. But these are serious issues.
You know?
And a lot of these things, I think, you know, Charlie has a really good track record of listening and really being concerned, I think, about the needs of the people. And I'm not so sure that someone like Paul Schell is going to be as concerned with what happens to the mom-and-pop business down on MLK or Rainier Avenue, wherever they run the RTA, and what happens to them when they build it.
Or you'll wind up with Pier 95 in Genesee, you know?
Something like that. I think Schell's vision is going to be, you know, really on, in trying to be visionary, he forgets what's in front of him, which is the people who live in this city now. And I think that's something that we have to remember and something that we haven't paid enough attention to.
And he forgets who he's working for. That he's working for all the people of this city.
I see. He has other ideas.
I think he works for people. I just think he works for a relatively narrow slice of the city. And Charlie, as Matt has said, has a much better track record of being open, being responsive, of listening to people before he's made up his mind, as opposed to, you know, anybody who has been involved in public process in Seattle. You know, knows the syndrome of what public hearings are like, where there's very few members of the public and there's very little hearing going on. And the decisions have already been made. And then you go through the process of ratifying it, you know, by whatever.
Well, you showed up, therefore they had the hearing, therefore they have validation.
That's, exactly. That's and that kind of process is a major part of what this election has been about, I think, and all the races.
Okay. Let's kind of close up. We've got a couple minutes left.
Sure.
Two quick questions. The campaign financing, the funding, what is the ratio? I know that depends.
Right now, I think, actually, we've done better than we thought since the primary. We're at about, I think, $125,000 since Charlie jumped in the race. Last I saw, Shell's at about $260,000. So we're only being outspent 2-1 at this point, or maybe a little more than that. Mm-hmm. Of course, you've got independent expenditures from labor. I just saw the hit piece they released today saying Charlie wants to privatize Metro, and Charlie doesn't want to privatize Metro. That's a lot of bull.
You've also got media coverage, which doesn't count as campaign expenditures.
Well, I was going to say that the Times Ed page should be declared as an in-kind contribution to
exactly.
a Shell's campaign on his C4s, but I don't think it's going to happen. So there's going to be a lot of other money, I'm sure, spent out there on his behalf, and we're out there plugging away. We're definitely in this thing, and I think Charlie's going to win, and I think he's going to be a great mayor. And I think 4 years from now, 10 years from now, people are going to look back and go, you did a pretty good job.
Yeah, and I think in order for that to happen, people have got to get motivated. They got to go out. Chong's campaign needs a lot of help because it's the grassroots support that's going to make that victory happen.
Okay, in terms of the primaries, how important was the 7-point or 6-point difference? It's a new ball game. What?
Absolutely. And the other thing is that people have to vote. Okay. A lot of people didn't come out in the primary. I mean, it was a very low turnout primary. Shell hit real hard with the absentee mailers and a lot of the money stuff, which in a low turnout really shapes it. I think we're going to have much larger turnout in this coming election. And I think, absolutely, we're very much in there. And I hear there's a poll out there that says that we're very much in there. But it was done by people on the other side, so I don't get to see that stuff. But I'm hearing nervous.
I see.
I'm hearing they're nervous.
Okay. Well, that's excellent. So thank you, both of you, for coming. Matthew Fox, thanks. Geov Parrish, thanks. And from Network X, I'm David Fisher. And thanks for showing up tonight, all you viewers.
Thank you very much for having us.
Likewise.
Good.
America is essentially a dream.